So I've seen people ask about how to use the Watchdog timer on the Nano BLE, and I bothered to figure it out, so for the two of you that might be watching this, I figure what the hell, I'll show you how it's done. You don't need a library to do this. In fact, you don't need much more than what's on the screen right now. In fact, you don't even need half of what's on the screen right now for most uses. So I figured I'd just walk you through it. The Nano BLE, the Nano BLE Sense, and the Nano BLE Sense Rev 2 are all NRF52840 Nordic Semi ARM chips. It doesn't matter which of those boards you're using. All that really matters is that you're using some board that's based on that. This code should work. In fact, it'll probably work for other NRF52 series parts and possibly others, I don't know. You'd have to test it to find out. Basically, all you need to write this code, if you were to do it from scratch, is the datasheet, or as Nordic seems to call it, the product specification. I read the NRF52840 product specification version 1.1. The other thing you need are the CMSIS files. If you don't know what that is, CMSIS files are just something that come with your Arduino support. They're to radically simplify, they're a tiny bit of source code, mostly header files that define the hardware registers that you need in order to do anything with the peripherals on the device, including the Watchdog. So in here where you see NRF_WDT, and these CRV, REN, RR, and task chart, and so on, these are all defined hardware registers that you'd find in the datasheet. They're all accessible in code because of the CMSIS header files. I'll throw on screen the header that actually contains this definition, in case you're using this in a non-Arduino context, but I found, at least with the embed Nano board package that's used to support the Nano BLE and the Sense versions of it, all you need to do is include the Arduino.h header file, and it pulls in those headers for you, just transitively through its own internal include directives. Right, so in order to do this, what you need to do is set a countdown that you want. So how long you want it to be before the Watchdog timer goes off in the CRV member. Sorry, I'll zoom in so you can see better what's going on. You need to make this assignment here. So this is in timer oscillations. That's 32.768 kilohertz oscillations. So if you put 32,768 here, that will set a Watchdog time, well, a Watchdog timeout of exactly 1 second. So that's how you specify that. To actually get it to take effect, you need two things. First, you need to enable one of the so-called reload registers, or potentially more, but you need to enable at least one. Here, I'm enabling reload register 0. So what I'm doing is storing a 1, an REN, that's bit index 0 set to a 1, total value of 1. So that enables this next line to actually do something. And here, in order to get the timer to reload the counter from CRV into its own internal timekeeping mechanism, you need to assign this so-called magic value to it. This magic value is actually just a 32-bit number that's defined to the characters NRF5, lowercase n, capital R, capital F, 5. I spent the time to work that out because it was bugging me that they just had this number they didn't explain. So I thought, well, let's just see what the ASCII code characters work out to for the bytes in it, and sure enough, it's NRF5. And then you assign this task start thing to get it going. Now, you probably don't have to keep doing this. You necessarily assign CRV each time. You don't need to assign REN each time, and you don't need to assign task start each time, I don't think. I don't know because there's simply no cost to doing it again and again, so that's how I've set the code up. That by itself is basically all you need to use the watchdog timer. I will trim this code down a bit so you can see what the magic value is, but that's pretty much it. You do that, the watchdog timer is started, and once you start the watchdog timer, there's basically nothing you can do about it after that other than keep reloading counts. So you can't actually stop it once you've started it, short of resetting the device one way or another, whether that's a watchdog reset or some other kind of reset. The reason for these reload registers is ostensibly so that you could have multiple things that need to quote-unquote kick the dog. So if you had multiple processes going on inside your code and you wanted to make sure they were all tending to the watchdog timer, you would specify more bits in the REN register. And in order for the counter to be loaded into the internal timekeeping of the watchdog, all of the RR registers that you've enabled have to have this magic value assigned to them. So the idea is various parts of your code would be assigning their own reload registers. So you might have a reload register for your main loop, and you might have one for some background task, that kind of thing. The other thing that you can do with the NRF52 watchdog timer is you can have it fire off an interrupt. There seems to be some confusion about this, so I'll just explain that. You can use the interrupt, but it's not like the AVR microcontroller where you can basically stay in the interrupt indefinitely. You can acknowledge the watchdog timer and resume normal operations if you're in the interrupt. That's an option. On the NRF52 device, there is no such thing. Basically, the way it works is if you enable the interrupt functionality, what it does is it delays the watchdog by supposedly exactly two of the 32 768 kilohertz oscillation cycles. In other words, it's supposed to give you about 61 microseconds worth of time in the interrupt, and that's all you get. When that goes off, whether you do something useful with it or not, the chip is going to reset. So you have some time to save some diagnostic values or to shut off a relay coil or who knows what, but you will not be able to simply acknowledge the interrupt and resume business. So if you're thinking that that's something that's possible, it is not possible with the NRF52840. I have noticed that there are some other NRF series parts that you can stop the watchdog timer and sort of recover from that situation, but this is not one of them. So I have put this all into one function, and if a null pointer is passed in for this optional WDT interrupt handler, it simply doesn't use the interrupt handler. So you can see here I'm checking to see if it's null. If it's not null, rather, I enable the IRQ for the watchdog interrupt service routine, so it'll actually run, and then I assign it the function pointer, basically, for the interrupt handler so it knows what to execute when that interrupt goes off, and then an in10 set of 1 here saying this interrupt is enabled. This is interrupt enable set, so you put a 1 in there, it causes that interrupt to be enabled, or to be set. It's kind of a confusing variable name, but I trust you understand what I mean by that. So let me condense this down, and I'll show you the whole thing. I'm going to remove a bunch of stuff that doesn't need to be in here. I kind of built a library around this, but that's really not necessary. And I included a bunch of STD chrono support, that half of which doesn't work because of because C++ 17 isn't enabled on I'm gonna get rid of my comments here. C++ 17 isn't enabled for this board support, so there's some functions that I can't use in there. So there's that and that. Here's all the chrono stuff that I'm just going to get rid of because it's just in the way. Okay, and down here I put a little bit of example of how I'm using it. So you need this reload value, which is in fact just these letters, NRF5. This is just basically, you know, it's written as a static assert, but what this is really is just documenting the fact that that's what that value is. So I'm going to get rid of that because it's not actually needed. And I'll put this at the top. Normally this would be included automatically, you know, for you when you're doing this in an Eno file. So, right. If you're not going to use the interrupt functionality, you could just completely get rid of all of that. And these are off by default, so you don't need that. And you don't need this thing about the original handler. So basically, if you just want to use it in its basic functionality, this is all you need. In fact, we could get rid of this as well. So there you go. Everything from here on up is pretty much all you need to use the watchdog timer. All you have to do is call this function with however many oscillations you want to kick forward in time for. And once you start doing that, you have to keep doing it. I'm just going to back the code up here the way I had it, just because I'm going to show you what I had down here. This is how I tested it. I defined my own interrupt handler routine because part of what I wanted to know was that behavior. And I've set it up so it just toggles the pin. I don't know how fast it's toggling it. It doesn't really matter. I just wanted it to toggle fast enough so that on an oscilloscope, I could capture it and see how much time did it spend in that handler. It wasn't strictly necessary that I toggle it, but I wanted to prove that the code was still executing. And I'll throw that up on the screen. This is the trace that I captured. And as you can see, it's not staying in there for 61 microseconds. It's actually staying in there for a little bit longer, 72 microseconds. I don't know why that is. It's possible that they understated how long it would stay in there. It's possible that the 32 kilohertz timing source is just not that accurate. I haven't actually looked to see if it's just like an RC oscillator or if it's you know, trimmed somehow or what. But anyway, in theory you should have at least 60 microseconds or so to do something and then wait for the proper, you know, the watchdog proper to kick in. And that's it. So just for testing purposes, my test code was calling this, which was advancing the time, the watchdog time, by 6 seconds. I defined this above to be 32,000, well, this right here, to be 32,768. So if I cut this down, you can basically rewrite what was on the screen and it should work just fine for you. Let's see here. Don't need that. Right. So there it is in its essential parts. And if you're interested in the rest of it, you can back the video up and use the data sheet and use that code as a guide to figure out how to set up the interrupts. But Very few people are actually interested in that feature, but if you want to do it, the code you were seeing before does do that. Anyway, I hope either of you found this useful. Nobody's actually watching any of my videos right now, so I'd be surprised if anybody finds this, or beyond that, if they found it actually useful. But if you did, let me know.